All right. Well, this has been a rich and full day thus far. It's just been wonderful to hear from each of you. I really appreciate the discussion today. And we want to use this last session as a very open discussion, creating conversation across the panels that we had, facilitate some of that conversation, and facilitate some conversation with the audience, those of you who have been here listening to these presentations. So I'm interested. I'll launch a first question for you all. And this question is growing out of the last session that we had, but bringing into it the morning sessions that we had. And it goes something like this. I'm interested in, Stuart was talking about V.L. Temperley, and you mentioned as you were talking about him that in coming to terms with his work, interpreting his work, somehow attention to the his religion, his theology, has to be, we have to make something of it. But I think the phrase you used was, we have to be careful that we don't make too much of his theology in our interpretation of the work, and we have to be careful that we don't make too little of it. And that strikes me as an issue that has been running through the whole day, is how do we make, if we err on the side of making too much of religion or too little of it, that seems to be the central issue, how we go about that. And I'm interested in the fact that we got particular examples in that last session from Amanda and from Edgar and from Stuart. I'm wondering, and this is a question for all of you, including the artists who just presented, what role, in choose one of the examples of the artists, what role does religion or theology or spirituality, you can set your own terms, have to play in the interpretation of their work, the discussion about their work, the writing or speaking about their work? If we were to choose an example, whether it's Edgar's work or Amanda's show, her paintings, or one of the artists that Stuart referenced, how can you see religion, theology, spirituality having a positive role to play in the interpretation of that work? Ready, go. Does that make sense as a question? Is that okay? Okay.
Can I start with Amanda?
Yeah.
So, I mean, bringing Malevich in and thinking about that pure black square that he ultimately migrated away from back to figuralism, but he's doing that to illustrate apophatic theology. No longer, for me, does that have to be this apotheosis of the history of art with a pure black square. What I see in Amanda's work is, hey, let me revel in apophatic theology for a few more hours, maybe weeks, months, years, and make a home in that apophatic stillness. Not it to be a crescendo point, but a place for further exploration, a more hospitable black square. So weaving it in, as we did with Friedrich, into art history is what opens up the theological possibilities of work like yours. That might be one way of proceeding.
Well, I feel like I'm going to get a little out of depth here, maybe, but I find Malevich's work to be perfectly hospitable. I love. In fact, I was just telling John. I was rereading. There's a wonderful. Bob Nickus has a wonderful essay in the introduction to his book on abstraction. It's a big orange book with a white circle on it. You should read it. But he has this wonderful introduction. He was talking about that work, and I've known the work, and I follow the history of painting and art history. I'm very excited about that, and for some reason, it just struck me as like this wonderful gesture. He, that painting that you're talking about in this exhibition, which I think was at a gallery called like Life on Mars. It was like this final exhibition. It was so wonderful, and like they were really just pushing their ideas, right? I mean. He puts this painting in the corner of the room, right? Everyone probably knows this, but that just struck me anew as really interesting that he's suggesting, I think, in that gesture that the painting is touching two different planes, and that in doing that, it's opening up a different dialogue. Mm-hmm. So even as it negates possibilities of representation, he's always playing with that anyways. I think he's more, to me, what interests me about his work is the ways in which he suggests the limits of mm-hmm. abstraction and representation and where they might overlap. And I think he also feels no obligation to us to pick a camp and right. stick in it, because he's really curious, right? He's making the work as a way of thinking through these questions. So I love that work. And I think in a way, I don't think that work is passé either. I think there's a lot of history of like black or dark paintings and minimalism, and each of these paintings has its own set of concerns. So right. when we talk about the Malevich painting, when we talk about Ed Reinhart, when we talk about Steve Perino making black paintings, like these are all different conditions that need to be met on their own, in their own context, and I love that. And I love that though aesthetically there may be a strong through line, I think each object presents itself as a unique instance mm-hmm. that requires our curiosity in relation to it. So.
And you feel okay with if Matt is reading your work as negative theology and talking about the unspeakable, the being beyond being, that kind of stuff? Is that
I don't know why
okay.
I just had a flush of anxiety. No, I'm not okay with that because you haven't seen the work. So I would say being in the space and looking at the work would be the first place to start.
Sitting in that beautiful chair that you placed in the gallery for a while.
Yeah, I mean, and you can't see it from there. I think if you sit in the furniture, and the furniture, so I mentioned earlier the paintings are 13 by 12, so they're oriented in a vertical fashion. The furniture is oriented so that the long end is against the wall. Something that delighted me as like a dork out artist detail is that they're just deep enough that if you sit on them and try to lean against the wall, you fail, right? It's really uncomfortable, you sort of fall. So then it suggests like, well, maybe I need to scoot back, but then at that point it's kind of inappropriate, like, well, my feet are out in the air. It's this really wide yeah. piece of furniture, but it's not like for two people, it's just big enough for one. So I think in the end the furniture suggested that you should sit kind of crisscross and like really inhabit the whole space and like settle in. And I loved that. And that wasn't about then, oh, do that to consider the work. You know, I do think there are strong, I mean, so I mentioned earlier some of my anxieties about painting is like if I choose to make paintings that are very textural or dark or have this kind of reference point to art history, I just came to a place of needing to no longer answer to all of those references, yeah. right? There are concerns in, I mean, Rauschenberg's black paintings are amazing. Mm-hmm. What he's doing is, there are some similarities, but he's very different from what I'm doing, from what in Reinhardt, you know. So I'm more curious about the individuality and the context of those things as a site for exploration and dialogue.
And if anyone's concerned that this is too much of a theological intrusion upon work like this, we know from Modern Art and Life of Culture, his book was called God Is Not Cast Down when he was commenting upon his own black squares. So if we have to have that permission if he's granting that to us.
So, I can't resist coming
please,
in here.
Please.
So Jonathan's been very modest through this day and not talking about his own book. But something that we were talking about, I was talking about to you yesterday about your book, I think is pertinent here, and that is the difference between intentional and non-intentional or anti-intentional interpretations. It's an ongoing issue in art history when the artist is dead and so let's say didn't leave any papers or whatever, you know, there are moments when art historians bypass intentionality. And we're getting close to that conversation again here, and it hasn't been opened very much today. So if Amanda said, I really hate that black square, I don't think about it at all, how far would you go? Would you keep going with either Malevich or anything, negative theology or any rest of that? You were talking about this in relation to your collaborative book. That's why I'm mentioning it, because you were saying you were slightly more happy with non-intentional readings than your co-author was.
Yeah, that's true.
Fine.
Well, Stuart mentioned that he thinks there's something to proceeding into an art discourse taking seriously that humans are spiritual creatures, I think is the phrase that you used, right? And if you take that seriously, then presumably that is an interpretable dimension of the work that can be discussed beyond the artist's intentions, in the same way that a feminist critic might say, well, whether you're thinking directly about it or not, people are gendered beings and you're making objects that have gender codes built into them. Same with maybe a Marxist critic saying, whether you're thinking about it or not, there's power inscribed in these objects and in the ways that people treat them socially. I think a similar argument could be made theologically or...
What I'm interested in is whether or not you think that, you know, that in the domain of spiritual, religious, and other belief questions of belief and faith, do you have more or less freedom than art historians would when they're talking about other subjects to depart from the intentionality of the artist?
Right. I'm hesitant to want to claim more freedom. I mean, whatever, if theological criticism is going to proceed, it has to proceed always by arguing from evidence, in the same way that a feminist critic has to argue from evidence. It can't all be projection, and same with a post-colonial critic or whatever. Though I do think that once you bring theology in, you're talking about such a big, but potentially overloaded topic or line of questioning, and I think that at least allows for a lot of play in the ways that we're interpreting works. Play, it has to be responsible, but play.
Well, I mean, for someone, art is too, this is Amy Knight Powell from her book, Depositions. Art is too promiscuous to remain art is too promiscuous to remain faithful to its author's intentions. Art is too promiscuous to remain faithful. And that opens up a whole range of meanings for her. And it means that you can have artists saying that Roger van der Weyden is actually a nihilist and the pits in the nativity scene are inner depths that are about to unleash with the disenchantment of the world. I've seen Renaissance art historians say that. I want to say, good for you. Let your freak flag fly. Make it happen. Now let me do some art historical work to say, actually, those wells are intended to signify the depths that will burst with water when the light of the Epiphany star shines into them. That's actually what Roger van der Weyden meant. So I think that art history, the referees are leaving the field, and there are all kinds of possibilities that weren't there before. And I'm so glad Amy Knight Powell is doing what she's doing through Zone Books. But it makes room for a different kind of people to enter the game.
So my first thought in trying to answer that question is way too abstract, but to say that theology, at least in my view, opens up imaginative possibilities in engaging with art. So that's a very nice thing for me, or I think it's a very nice thing for me to say and put out there. But I would be remiss to not point to examples. And he's probably too modest to bring it up, but Jeffrey Kosky's book is a great example of that happening. So the question is not whether, I mean, I think the question that concerns those of us that are interested in seeing a religious discourse return to art critical conversation shouldn't be whether or not theology can be part of the conversation, but how theology is part of the conversation. And I think Jeff models really well how theology can be employed to open up new questions and new avenues of consideration, and it's not didactic prose that marches through an argument, and so I do commend Arts of Wonder for your reading, because it's fascinating, but it's also enjoyable to read, which is nice every now and then. So I feel like I need to write a review, to put all this down in black and white. But I just really enjoyed the reading of that book, and that can happen when you're talking about religion and theology and contemporary art. But the choice of theme and theological resonance were made very carefully, and that's why it's, I think, a well-written book. So talking about Diller and Scafidia, and the cloud of unknowing, you know, that's, there's a lot there. You can spend a lot of time with that. So I would commend Jeff's book as an example of how that can happen, which doesn't close down all these other options, but invites some new avenues of consideration that you know, I think one of the concerns in the second panel were, okay, if religion is coming back, well, what are the aspects of religion that we want to allow, or what do we want to privilege, you know, and not an interior, strictly personal or private experience of religion, but something external and communal. And I think Jeff's work is a good example of that, so I just want to promote it here.
Jeff, I'd love to hear you respond to that if you like.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What's that? I'm not sure what, there's not much more to say after that. One of the things interesting in the exchange, one of the things that interested me in the exchange between Amanda and Matt, if I remember when Amanda was talking about her work, she said, you know, I'm not actually thinking about religion or religious themes or religious issues or theological doctrine or, you know, any. I'm thinking about empathy. I'm thinking about making a comfortable place for people to have a, I don't know, refuge. I don't know, that wasn't your word, but I'm looking for a place where people can sit as opposed to having to stand up all the time in their lives, and some place where they won't be startled by others, you know? And nothing she said there was really about religion. I'm not trying to make a space that's religious. I'm not trying to make a space that illustrates a particular doctrine. I'm not trying to make a space that can promote a certain experience of X, Y, or Z, put whatever God you want in there. And yet it seems as if, or Matthew and many of us probably would feel, that the kinds of concerns that were moving her to make that work, or the kinds of effects that we experienced in that room, would be like or similar to, or they would also be effects that we would experience, undergo, if we were in identifiably religious spaces. Mm-hmm. And so I think one of the things that I try to do is to, I mean, I guess I think about religion and art. It's not that art makes religious spaces, but that they both address, or that art is good at addressing longings, desires, meanings that religion is also really good at, has a very long tradition of being expert at. And that's why, you know, Stuart, I think, pointed to the point at which you are trying to, and you're the creative artists, but where you're trying to say something, and you find yourself given over to a vocabulary that might be commonly found in religious traditions. Mm-hmm. I guess that would be one way I think about what I'm trying to do. And again, it's not art history, obviously, that I'm doing.
But it almost feels as like if you were to take, I mean, your summary there makes sense to me, but it's almost as if the way in which you're framing the question is if to say that if it ends there, then you're denying its religious roots somehow, right? And that's sort of the part of this particular way in which you frame the question that makes me feel like, you know, we need to talk about, like, is religion a container and, you know, it holds things in it? Or is the, like, is religion a form, a shape, mm-hmm. of a particular set of interactions, and it had a different name before it was called religion? Like, is it a kind of an eternal set of, or fundamental set of interactions and terms and images and shapes?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes I think of it as religion and art. It's not that art gets at religious themes, but religion and art get at something about human existence in the world. I guess that's how I go. I mean, I was interested in the way that, you know, you guys, the makers up here, were kind of befuddled by the categories, you know, religion, secular. Like, I just don't think about those categories when I'm doing my work, you know, and like the creative life seems to be apart from those. And so whenever I try to get in there and tell you that's religious or that's secular, you're just like, it doesn't help. It doesn't seem like it helps further the process to me. But if I tell you something about...
You have something to say as well. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I think the reason that I don't prefer to... So for me, this comes into what I was talking a little bit about, the institutionalization and consensus about things. I think the need, we're all very educated and we are passionate about our disciplines. We have a lot of information. It's really easy to look at something and your brain, right, the card catalog starts flapping through all the different associations, ideas, philosophy, all this stuff. I think that's a great task if mm-hmm. there's pleasure and insight that comes from that. Mm-hmm. But I think if the task there is to label and to feel comfortable, like I now know what this thing is, I can put it in its place, like it's part of my project, that to me feels so violent mm-hmm. and so sidestepping what I liked that you were saying to everybody this morning about. You went so far as to say, you know, that someone would engage the work, maybe devote themselves to it, right? I think the idea of like really sincerely being curious, like what is this thing, right? I'm confronted with this show, mm-hmm. this object, these ideas that I actually don't know what it is yet, mm-hmm. even if it looks like a thing, mm-hmm. you know? I know what it looks like, I can put it, I can place it in history or conversation, and yet I still don't know it unless I investigate it. And, you know, I think I was talking a broad stroke of maybe what I was talking about in my own practice is like being willing to have a little skin in the game. Mm-hmm. And I think that people who are writing art history, critics, should have the same. And I appreciated what Stuart was saying. You know, being willing to really participate in a collaborative relationship of figuring out what this thing is, right? Because it's like so interesting the way that art can be a conduit for people to understand each other or approach big ideas. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm interested in, and so I balk a lot at the idea of too quickly placing something into a grand project yeah. that a certain writer or historian might have, because you're just missing the opportunity to be present in time and space with the thing and be surprised. So I think that's what I'm thinking.
I feel like in some ways, the comment I want to make is related to that, and in some ways, I'm skipping over things. But I want to come back to the issue of whether what got said in the second panel was an assertion that religion has been seen as private and ought to be seen as otherwise, because that actually wasn't, this goes to too quick categorization, to the ways in which thinking, I mean, from my perspective, the sort of problematic of the post-secular being one that reintroduces binaries. And I like the kind of openness you're talking about, the sort of approaching with openness, which strikes me as a way kind of not only to approach artworks we're unfamiliar with, but a way to approach people. Mm-hmm. My comment this morning about religion and privatization was really intended to describe what secularization theory did to religion. It tried to remove its, to remove its more public aspects, but I was not saying that I think religion should therefore, like, are we gonna buy into that and just do the opposite? Should religion cease being private and become something that is only public? No, public and private, that's another set of binaries that really are in many ways co-constitutive and exist on a kind of spectrum, and religion, like other things in our lives, ought to be able to occupy the spaces that are appropriate to it. We should be able to observe religion where we see it and not kind of have a set of, only there, but not there. And I think that's, one of the places where secularization theory gets it wrong is to say religion is simply a private phenomenon, and if it exists inside, it's okay, and if it doesn't, well, then it's pre-modern and we, or naive, or, I mean, even worse, in the sort of racialized, colonialized language, mm-hmm. Primitive, and so that, right. Yeah, I'll stop there.
I wanted to say that part of what I really appreciated about the artist panel, the last panel that went, was how much it seemed that you all embody the kind of freedom to not reinstantiate this secular religious binary that I think that in scholarly critical practice that I'm trying to reach for, and that I think that the term post-secular that I want it to reach for, right? Mm-hmm. Because I mean, what we think about the idea of the secular and modernity as it emerges is that it, the idea of the secular emerges and constitutes religion as something that can be separated off from human life, right? And it's that separation that I want to refuse. I want the freedom to be fully human and to not have to label, this is religious, mm-hmm. this is secular, and I have to divide it up or quarantine it or whatever, mm-hmm. like this. I really, you know, I share Stuart's sense that he's shared in his talk about, you know, for me personally, the fundamental spirituality of all human existence and of art making, you know? I mean, I get that in literature from someone like Wordsworth, someone like Marilynne Robinson. I mean, mm-hmm. her always reflecting on, I mean, what it is to be human, what it is to half perceive and half create the world around you. That's Wordsworth's great phrase mm-hmm. from Tintern Abbey, you know? But that's a holy thing for Wordsworth. I mean, I'm Christian and romantic with Wordsworth in that, you know? He says mm-hmm. in the prelude that when he gets his great artistic vision of what is he going to write about, what is going to be his great calling, he says that he's going, you know, here I might pause and bend in reverence to men as they are men within themselves. Mm-hmm. He says, and he uses that, he makes an analogy between the human soul, the spirit that goes on, and what happens in a church. He says, how oft high service is performed within when all the external man is rude and show. Not like a church rich with pomp and gold, but a mere mountain chapel such as shields its simple worshipers from rain and shower. Hmm. Is it really lovely, right? That what happens inside our mind when we half perceive and half create and really engage in the world, I mean, the way that artists talk about, my husband's an artist, I love to, like, you know, talk with him. It's a revelation for me, you know, hearing how people talk about creative process, you know, because it's an exploration of what it is to be human, what it is to be in God's image, I think. I mean, as a Christian, mm-hmm. that's why I think that it's like this. And that's holy and beautiful. And I don't have to put religious language on it to appreciate yeah. the holiness or beauty of yeah. that. But I also don't want to be told that I can't talk about it in those terms, you know. I would want many of us to be able to reflect in all kinds of different languages on yeah. that fundamental human, artistic, half-perceiving, half-creating experience.
To add to that, one of the funny things about being a parent, like my daughter's 10 years old, so you understand fundamentally that the things that you say to your kid that you never thought you would say, that your parents said it to you, that, like, she's like, how far does that go back? Like, is that like 1,000 years of, like, somebody saying, I will never say that to my child, right? But when you start to reflect upon the cliches of certain kinds of sayings, at a certain point, you're at a perspective in which you can actually recognize the depth of the metaphor, right? Like, you think cliches are flat, and then at a certain angle, you recognize that they're, like, deeply bloated with wisdom. And to some degree, I mean, you know, metaphors are, some of them can be really, really powerful when you recognize how they are literally ingrained within the physics of our world. Right, so, like, you know, when Dr. King's, you know, I have a dream speech, I may not get to the mountaintop with you, is powerful. You know, it also, it brings us to think about, you know, traveling through the valley of the shadow of death. You know, I may not get there, I may not get to the other side, you know. So, you know, I think that most Americans recognize that the civil rights movement is deeply connected to religion. Like, they, because the metaphor has expressed that. But there is a part where the metaphor has become stripped of its politic. And then you start to wonder, like, about the usefulness of the image itself, right? Because them rendering Dr. King in a rock, I don't know if you guys have seen this in DC, I have major problems with this piece, as you can tell. He's literally embedded, half of his body is stuck in a rock. He's 35 feet tall. And, you know, I think that to some degree, like, most Americans now are somewhat disillusioned by the idea, because they're like, well, maybe we might not ever get to the mountaintop. Maybe this is as good as it gets. And maybe we should just ditch the metaphor entirely. If it's going to render Martin Luther King as a superhero, as a 35-foot-tall man, and but then, like, have the conditions gotten that much better? Just to kind of like to try to interrogate our relationship to religion, because these things are around, we live with them on a regular basis, but then they have this other issue, is that we don't recognize that their origin isn't something deeply political, and it's about transforming society. You know, they kind of lose their, I don't know, they get crystallized, I guess, or they, something happens to them.
Okay, let's take a couple questions from the audience. If any of you have a question, we've got a microphone over there and one over here. Anyone?
Yeah. Hi. So I have a question about kind of like the separation of, I don't know, like presuppositions about who I am as an artist and my work. So like, I'm a Christian, like I'm a Christian, and I make work, but I don't make Christian work. And like, so if I were to have like, so if people come to my show here at the Bible Institute of Los Angeles, is there like an implicit theological criticism or reading of my work that like I can't ever separate myself from? That it's like, I don't know, not necessarily that that's bad, but it's like, I feel like every time I go show something or do anything, and I have on the press release, BFA from Bible University, is there's like this theological criticism that's like already there before somebody even like sets eyes on my work. So yeah, I don't know. I don't know where the question is in that, but it's like, how do you guys see that as somebody else who is of a different spiritual background or is of just in the art criticism world or whatever, what advice would you have?
Can I just, I have a really simple kind of answer, a pretty straightforward Derridean answer to this. I'm gonna use Derrida, which is to say that, you know, there's not just you and there's not just your work, there's the context. Meaning takes place in this triangulation of you and that work and the context in which it shows. So it's, I mean, and every production, every scholarly production, every artistic production is open to that endless proliferation of meaning, because your work can get put in another context. So you're right. I think when your art is shown here at Biola, okay, everybody's gonna, you know, read it in this context. And but then what's exciting is that your work can get taken into wholly other contexts. And context that you have never even anticipated, and it can be open to meanings that you never intended or foresaw. And that's part of the endless possibility. I mean, that's the kind of freedom that is inherent in the things that we make. I mean, it's a freedom that exceeds ourselves, and there's room for all manner of theological reflection in that, and the nature of God who creates a world in the same way, which has meanings which proliferate, you know, beyond maybe intention. You know, because he allows for freedom, and also of our own works. And then doesn't that lead us to some kind of generosity in how we interpret, when we look at people's art or their literature, how vulnerable it is, you know, how to get resituated out here in the middle in a different context someplace. So
that was, oh, sorry.
No, I'd like to hear what you have to say about that. I
was just thinking that was a very, very generous kind of an answer. So I have a very ungenerous kind of an answer, cynical kind of an answer, because your question reminded me of that column that runs in the Sunday New York Times, The Ethicist. You have an ethical question, because artists are always changing their CVs for political gain, for career gain. But is it ethically okay to remove the name Biola in particular from your CV? It would seem to be a different relation between that institution and your education than others. And then on a completely different note, I would also just like to ask you, how do you know your work's not Christian?
I don't. I really like the way that you responded to that. It's like, it's not, I'm not thinking about deep theological means when I'm making. I don't make Christian work. I'm just a Christian, and I start making things, and things happen. So it's like, yeah, I don't. It's like if somebody were to fish for it, they would find it in their own way, maybe. But yeah, I don't know. I'm just thinking about the current work that I'm making right now. I'm not. There's no iconography. There's no things that I implicitly have put there to show that I'm a Christian or to maybe try to stir within somebody these theological concepts, but they do have to do with empathy and with expressing feeling emotions and things like that. So yeah, they could be Christian, but I don't know necessarily that they are. They could be just as much Muslim. I don't know. So yeah.
Sounds like an internal conflict. I think you have to work it out, because if you feel as though your work not being overtly Christian is somehow a deficit of your sense of who you are, then that's really kind of a personal thing that you have to work out. Yeah, I would just kind of stick with that. But also, you know, it's tough in the art biz, so, you know, being making work that's overtly religious, there are real hurdles there, so don't deny that your recognition of that reality. But, you know, the art world is kind of like the Statue of Liberty, you know, it's like we take your weak, you're poor. So, you can make it for sure. I mean, there's an opportunity for you to be like that one dude who kicks down all the doors. He's like, I'm Christian, and you're wearing a waving a flag, and we all love you for it. So you could be that dude. I mean, the opportunity is there. You know what I mean? Don't see it as a deficit. You could work it, you know?
But I don't think you have to either. I mean, for somebody who did this or, you know, is on the ground in a commercial gallery setting. I mean, everybody here is in it, I think, in their own way. But I think the gallery world, let's say, can be very clumsy. It can be willfully blind. But it's willing to be enraptured. It's willing to be shown beauty and convinced. And you can make that, you have the freedom to make that argument with or without mentioning anything thematically religious. I mean, it's part of who you are, so I think I would say, you know, it's let it run through you in whatever way you feel like it should, and the power that can be generated from that will show you the way to bring your work into the world, I think, and to be shrewd and critical about how to meet the context where you want to show it, and that's a conversation that you can drive. And again, that I think the art world, the gallery world, let's say, is it wants to be shown beautiful things and interesting things, and it also wants to meet interesting people. And again, that's the place where you can reveal as much or as little as you currently feel is in your heart is you want to include in that conversation. But I would just say, yeah, the art world, the people in it want to be in rapture. They want to hear what you have to say as if it's a convicting, beautiful thing. So, yeah.
Make your paintings dress as the Pope. It's a bad joke.
I also teach, so I think I'm hearing this question from, you know, just as young artists thinking about where they're heading and how they want to proceed. I think the biggest thing I would say is whatever is causing you anxiety, whether it's a question of religious identity, whether it's a question of is your work cool enough or contemporary enough or big enough or small enough or pretty enough or critical enough, I think the answer is probably take 6 months off from asking that question and obsess about your work and dive in and make a lot of it and talk with people and then see in 6 months if those still bother you to the same degree. Because I think sometimes people spend too much time, that's a little comfort zone to be I have these big questions, I can't proceed. It's no, actually you make the work or you don't. So make more work.
Yes.
I'll say something and we'll do one more question, sorry. I want to speak to that just very briefly, only to say that I think what's being argued here is the inclusion of theological and religious lines of questioning as relevant lines of questioning, but you should object to that line of questioning domineering your work. In the same way that anyone else, you should object to a formalist reading dominating the reception of your work. So I would say, don't be worried about it being a relevant line of questioning, but we have to object to it being totalizing, I think, which happens to people who graduate from Christian schools, and you just have some work to do there. Okay, let's do one more question, and then we'll have some quick responses.
I was reflecting on the fact that through most of history that I know much about, in any place that you go, whether it's Africa, Asia, Europe, the Americas, a lot of the origin of creating objects was religious and is today, depending on where you go. So a lot of the origin and the impetus for creating what we come to call works of art, the Hopi Indians were mentioned earlier, et cetera, was to create devotional objects. Let's just go there. And so we now, since, you know, probably the last 400 or 500 years, that's been shifting in the West in particular. I think it's shifted in other parts of the world much later because of the impact of the West, frankly, in its contacts with the rest of the world. So what I want to know is, what about the person who wants to create a devotional object, a real live devotional object, right now in 2017? Can that devotional object, can the art world, the global art world, can find and see a devotional object that art world will consider a true work of art or just a devotional object? Is it remotely possible? I mean, icons are now looked at as great works of art. Rublev is considered a great artist. Well, he wasn't doing it to be a great artist. He was doing it out of devotion to the Trinity. For example, to name but one example. So is it possible for the art world to recognize an object made as a devotional object, painting, an installation even, a sacred space, but a specifically devotional one? I'm elaborating my own question. Is it possible for that to be considered a great work of art today?
Any no's?
Who was that again?
No. Yeah. Anyone voting no? Okay. Is it
art in contemporary consensus. Religion, we could call it.
What's that?
The strange place of art in
contemporary religion. Yeah, yes, right. And it would be discussable, I presume. I mean, so to be considered a great work of art, it would be discussable within the art community? As a devotional object, as a great work of art?
It raises the opposite question of the intentionality issue that was coming up here, right? Because you're describing a situation where somebody's intending to make a devotional object, and then you have the art historians coming along and saying you've made a great work of art, which I think is the opposite of this. It's an inversion of the situation you've been describing here, where I'm not sure what to do with that observation.
I would set some parts of that question. I think I wouldn't put it all together. Because, you know, our phones are our current devotional objects. You go anywhere and everyone's staring at them. And even the iPhone is really a masterpiece. I mean, it's 1,000 different technologies in that thing.
You know, well, a friend of mine who's coined the term for sacred spaces says that the most sacred space in the United States is Las Vegas.
Ooh. Well, there's a fair amount of...
Just think about it. Where do people go?
There is a lot of academic criticism today, or academic scholarship that is critical, would criticize the art world for appropriating a devotional object in that way. I'm not sure if let's say the answer is yes, the art world would say it's a devotional object. I don't know different perspectives would value that yes differently. And I'm not sure which you're looking for, you know. I think there's some anthropologists who would say if the art world calls it an art object, they don't get the point, and that's a problem with them. That's a colonizing gesture on their part. And yet you might I'm not sure, do you want it to be called? Like maybe you think that it should be called an art object.
I would agree that kind of there are probably multiple questions resident in that question. And I mean, just as an example, I mean, Alfred Barr goes to Russia to basically save, to save icons. And he does this by turning them into aesthetic objects. And, but what happens to all the priests and monks and who, you know, so at the expense of human lives, icons are, I was going to say resurrected, but, yeah. you know, so, yeah. I mean, well, sometimes turning devotional objects into art is really an act of violence.
Well, since it's late, I just thought I was going to add a paradox to this. There's a debate in philosophy of art, intermittent but ongoing, about whose standard example is an illusionistic painting, like an old master painting. The debate is whether or not you can look at the surface of it and see the imaginary landscape, the fictive landscape, at the same time, or do you have to toggle back and forth between those two? So if I apply that paradox to this, the question is, can you have an object which you have a devotional attitude toward and at the same time appreciate its aesthetic qualities? A lot of people would say no.
But you could toggle?
Yeah.
Okay.
And this will be my last reference to Jonathan and Bill's book, but when Natalia Goncharova tried to do that, she needed the space of the art world to experiment with her Russian Orthodox iconographical tradition, and the religious authorities removed her evangelist paintings because they were perceived as blasphemous. And so you could say to someone, if you want to become a great remake icons, good, get trained by religious traditions. Sometimes the religious traditions are ill-equipped to handle certain kinds of talent, which is why that tension between the contemporary art world and the religious world is necessary. That space might be important for some people seeking to make religious objects.
I'm very thankful that each of you was here today and contributing to this conversation. Please join me in thanking them.
Biola University prepares Christians to think biblically about everything, from science to business to education and the arts. Learn more at biola.edu.